Hello, fellow Thanagarians, I'm Pruitt, this is Jim Davis, and on today's WebDM, we take flight with...
The birds of a feather, man.
It's bird people on WebDM.
One pun!
3, 2, 1...
This episode is brought to you by Mage Hand Press. Pre-orders are now open for their sci-fi book, Dark Matter. With it, you get immediate access to their 275-page beta full of spaceships, blasters, feats, spells, a gadgeteer class, and more. And it's all compatible with everything else 5e has to offer.
This expansion is so flexible, you can make any kind of sci-fi campaign you've ever dreamed of. I've played this material, and it's awesome. And since we're talking about bird people, check out the Aarakocra.
Check out the links in the description.
Bird people, Jim Davis, bird people.
Bird people.
There's a lot of anthropomorphic races.
Oh, sure, right.
Like right.
There just aren't.
And there's always a bird person, sometimes very literally. Love you, Rick and Morty. Can't wait for the next season.
I like the imagery of it, right? Like, mm-hmm. when I think of bird people, I think of something like the old Shining Force video game. I only ever played, like, the first one. But in my mind, there were, like, these great bird people or something that you would call upon who would swoop down. And in my mind, they were these dashing and heroic figures. I think, like, part of the appeal of bird people is also sort of like the association with angels, and the humanoids with wings has a kind of thematic appeal to it. There's a lot you can do. It's a concept that's fertile ground, and Dungeons and Dragons has supported this sort of character archetype from as far back at least as first edition, right? Mm-hmm. Aarakocra and Kenku make their appearance there, and even as playable options in multiple editions. And so it's been with the game for a while, but it's also a concept that seems to vex many DMs, right?
Yeah.
Like it's a character concept that you often see on banned lists. Like, no, you can't have, you know, it's
no
like,
Aarakocra.
No Aarakocra, no variant tieflings, although that's for another discussion, I guess. But I like it, right? I like the thematics of it. I like the imagery of bird people. I like all the things that you can do with them.
Yeah.
The fact that there's a, you know, kind of an inconvenient thing or it changes the normal dynamic of a party is just like, well, that just is a different thing I have to adapt to. And, you know, I now just have to adjust to the fact that there's a PC in the party who can fly. To me, that's where I start with these things. So
yeah, most definitely. It's either the very proud race of bird people, whether it's a, you know, hot people,
right.
Or it's the very wicked, because then I think of the Dark Crystal.
Yes, yeah.
The Skeksis, like this kind of vulture carrion race of can't fly anymore.
You can't fly anymore. Well, I mean, like it speaks to like the symbolic magnitude of birds.
Yeah.
Right. Like we're talking like all the different heraldic devices and everything that appear throughout our, you know, our history that use birds as imagery. Eagles and the like are used in all sorts of political iconography and things like that. It's animal.
They're closer to God.
Right. Yeah. You know, they soar. They fly. Soar. They seem unbound by the cares and worries and of all of us. And you know they're predators. Some of them at least. Yeah. And all of that plays into and is fertile ground for character concepts that like take an element of, I don't know, burb imagery and then tease that out into a D&D or other fantasy RPG character archetype. And I think it's rich and fertile, and there's so much you can do with it that I think the fact that they can fly from the beginning is, you know, like, let's get over that. Let's talk about why in the world you would want to play one of these in the first place. What are some of your concepts and sort of go-to, like, when you think of bird people?
Well, when I'm thinking of bird people, I don't know if I want to start specific at first.
Go with where your heart tells
you. Well, what my heart tells me is, do you remember that Iron Heroes character I had that was all very bird imagery?
Oh yeah, yeah.
The awesome like dragon bone longsword and blah blah blah.
Right, the hawk sort of armor kind of thing. Yeah.
Yeah, I would play him as an Aarakocra. Like,
yeah.
Like I like the idea of that kind of not necessarily Egyptian, because a lot of times it's very Egyptian, like the guardian, kind of the temple guardian types.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Or guardians of religious orders.
Yeah.
But I do see that like it's just there, like whether it's kind of like an eagle or I like imagining like an Aarakocra as like an owl. The idea of like a giant faced owl, the huge like
right,
half moon,
like move its head all around.
Yeah, moving its head all the way around. Mm. That kind of like that's like okay, that's creepy.
Right, right, right. Like just the very type of bird that you would start with really determines a lot, yeah. Or can like set a tone for the type of mm-hmm. concept. You know, the eagle, I think, plays into that sort of proud, almost like paladin type imagery. And there's a lot you can do there with sort of warrior archetypes and warrior classes, but vulture, owl. I had an Aarakocra who was an archer, but I described them as like a shrike, one of those smaller birds that like takes their prey and throws it on sharp sticks and waits for it to be impaled and bleed out. It seems like really vicious, and it was like
you were just the one that figured out. Wait a minute, I can take the sharp sticks and put them into the people.
Right, that's how I was like. Oh yeah, he's an archer. Yeah, and you know, that was for a one shot, and was a you know like. Yeah, I want a flying archer to fight a bunch of Tarrasques, but
it worked.
It worked. It was good. Yeah, it was great. Playing with that idea, though, that you would take a bird that speaks to you, that you like, and then work from there is like, all right, what does this type of animal suggest? Like a vulture necromancer is a reskinned Aarakocra that I really feel like I want to play. And mm-hmm. I like, you know, can we make some changes here or even not, right? Like there's nothing, you know, in the races presented that I wouldn't accept, but I just want a figure that's sort of like that bald sort of featherless skin, you know, mm-hmm. and
the
weird neck. Yeah. and then it just like quickly devolves into like Skeksis from Dark Crystal.
The cobwebs clinging about mm-hmm. you all the time. You're hanging out in graveyards. I mean, come on.
You know, go with like say Circle of Spores Druid. And think along the terms of like, well, for one, D&D has the Vrock, which is a demonic vulture that shakes spore-like infestations off of its wings. You could easily just like take a page from that and say, yeah, my character's connected to one of these demons. I'm using Druid because it fits, you know, with the concept, but it's reskinned to be this sort of necromancer-like, moldy, disease-ridden animal wizard thing.
I mean, a lot of planes have druids, man.
Right, yeah.
So they'd have to be from prime material.
Exactly, right? You know, what kind of role they're going to have in the party, whether they're caster or archer.
Yeah.
And then the rare bird person meleeer.
Because they can get in there and get into a scrap. We'll kind of get into the options later for each race. The one that I played a Kenku warlock Raven Queen.
Yeah.
Because kind of feeding into their whole thing of like, I want to fly again and I can't fly. It's like, Raven Queen lets you fly.
Yeah.
The raven's right there in the title.
It's so, right there,
and
yeah.
So, yeah, I had an amazing time.
Yeah.
Every fine familiar, all your stuff is just birds.
It's just birds,
And you just lean hard into it. It's one way to do one of these concepts, or just go the opposite way.
First off, that combo really works because of, like, the imagery of ravens and Kenku and, like, other corvids, and it fits that trickster archetype. It mm-hmm. fits well with the flavor, the sort of, like, the base flavor of Kenku, and it was a fun combo to watch because everything clicked for it.
Yeah, especially, I mean, like, I live in Austin, and there's grackles everywhere, and they are some sneaky little bastards, let me tell you. Like, eating on patios here and just seeing how bold they are and, like, how they're, like...
Is that... You guys not watching?
I'm gonna go for that food. It's like, dude, that's on my table.
Right, that's right here.
So,
yeah,
reputation's a little warranted.
Sure.
As written in the book.
You know, it's not just the sort of like physical features of your character, but the place they have in the world and the place that they have in the party that really brings them to life. So, if you just have like bird people who are outliers, right? Like this is the only one anyone has ever heard of. That's mm-hmm. sort of one way to do it, and I think that's kind of the default for the baseline D&D races. But I'm interested in like the ways in which you can take bird people as a concept in whatever specific iteration it is, and make it a real part of your world. Like, is there a kingdom or a nation of them somewhere, or you know, what kind of reputation do they have in the world?
Yeah, in Starward Bound, we haven't gotten there. Mm-hmm. We might get there. I don't know. But on a planet, there is a. It's a grove of trees that has grown up into like this plateau. It's almost become like just like a geological formation because it's been growing for so long and petrifying. Mm-hmm. And so it's a plateau that has holes through it. So there's all these wind vents and tunnels that provide all this updraft. At the top is a race of Aarakocra, and they're very barn owl, very white, feathers, rims of dark feathers, that kind of thing. But they're guardians of this, and what it is a graveyard. And what a graveyard of what? Nobody knows. But they have been guarding it for 10,000 years, according to them.
Right.
And of course, Aarakocra live a lot shorter, so it's like...
Yeah, maybe it's, yeah, you know, 10,000 years.
You have to meet them first and find out how old they think they are,
right.
And you can kind of extrapolate, but it's one of those things like, we've been guarding this for 10,000 years,
right.
And they're very and they're very serious about what they do. It's created a problem with the locals, though, because of that.
Yeah. I like that because it suggests kind of a connection between a particular D&D race or culture and something of fantastical significance, right? A magical location or something. That has appeals to me. I know it kind of has the potential to feed into the D&D race being portrayed as monocultural and you know only one way. But if you can come up with like multiple instances of that and like, yeah, this is one version of bird people, there's another version that's over here. Maybe they do have a closer connection with some kind of god or mystical force or something that like say uplifted birds and gifted them with these new forms, or like people that had developed such a strong connection with the birds that they lived with or kept as you know companions or something that they transformed themselves into this kind of hybrid. Like we're playing Dungeons and Dragons here. Like there can be any number of crazy, insane reasons for there to be bird people about. You know,
yeah, pets and owners becoming alike.
you know, this curse that you know the Kenku supposedly suffer. What if it's net less of like the wings were taken away and it's just like this is what they do to thieves. They take away all of these things. They turn them into these wretched avian kind of creatures that can't even fly. And what if it began that way of like putting a bird beak on someone and feathers, and then it's just like some transmuter was like, let's just take this one step further.
Yeah.
And it just became the practice.
Enough transmuters start doing this, and so a colony forms nearby.
We're going to talk about the Garuda from Perdido Street Station, but there's another people in there who have a similar process done to them where they are basically become steampunk cybermen as punishment. It's like, oh, you committed a crime. We're going to, like, graft this giant, like, excavator arm to you so that you can help with construction. And now you're, you know, not even a person anymore. They have the Garuda, which are these desert-dwelling sort of, like, they're kind of, well, Garuda is a type of bird in our world. And they describe them as these sort of, like, proud warriors who have really only one crime in their society, which is a theft of choice.
Yeah.
And everything is framed in, if by your actions you caused another person to have less choices in their life, then you're guilty of that crime. So that includes all sorts of like murder and property theft and all kinds of things. And, you know, the story is very complex and centers around a Garuda and looking for ways to restore something. And I just like that idea of a group of these bird people living out somewhere and having this utterly like no property, no politics. Aarakocra are kind of like that. And and like really playing that out. What does that look like for that society? What reputation do they have in the world? What prevents other people from coming in and going like, yeah, well, we don't care that you don't think anything about this boundary of where our kingdom is. Like, how are you going to stop us? That it's worth thinking about those things if you're going to include these sorts of concepts and ideas in your world. And maybe they have a reputation for being like a nuisance or fearsome and just like, yeah, we tried conquering them, but it was too big of a hassle. you know, they can just fly, right? Like, it's not like you can't lay siege to them. They can just fly away, you know?
Yeah.
Thinking through those things are what really appeals to me about these non-standard races and cultures in Dungeons & Dragons.
Why don't we kind of go through some of the options?
The
official options here.
You're feeling your bird person character. You want to know how you can make this in Dungeons & Dragons. In the official books, there's two options available to you. And then there's some others that are compatible with 5th edition, but you'd want to get your Dungeon Master's permission to use. Most of these, because they're in supplemental books, you'd probably need DM permission. And just the fact that some of the options let you fly. There's a lot of DMs where flying PCs are on their ban list, and we'll talk to you guys later in the video.
Yeah.
But for now, we're looking at Aarakocra, which showed up in the Elemental Evil Player Companion, part of Princes of the Apocalypse, and then Kenku, which is part of Boles. What do you think about these two, right?
Well, I mean, to me, the Aarakocra, well, first off, Dex Whiz all the way around.
Sure, right, yeah.
You know?
Almost all of these have Dex Whiz. It's there, like, plus two Dex, plus one Whiz.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I guess the birds have always been associated with wisdom and...
Sure, eagle-eye, that kind of thing. It makes sense for Aarakocra, but not necessarily for
every single
bird
one?
Person yeah. concept. Yeah. yeah.
Here's the thing, is, yes, they can fly 50-foot fly speed, which is pretty
sure,
good.
Yeah. Oh,
you
yes.
know, that's mm-hmm. really nice. And they get a slash attack with their claws, and that's it.
That's kind of it, yeah.
I mean... They don't get any skills. They don't get any other abilities.
That 50-foot fly speed really is like counting for most of what other races would get.
They don't get dark vision.
Mm-mm.
I mean, you get an extra language.
You get an extra language. I suppose the always having a melee attack is nice, particularly because they make such great archers. So the fact that if you do find yourself in melee, you do have this attack, at least are you know never caught off guard in that respect.
Yeah, yeah.
To me, they make great rangers, they make great druids, they make great monks, right? Like, if you want speed.
Speed to burn.
right? But they can also make great rogues, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's a place for them as even meleeers. It'd be difficult, and if you're using point buy, it'd be tough to make, a strength-based one and make it work, but...
Well,
I wouldn't want to count it out, right?
You could make a light armor wearing, because it doesn't... You could wield a shield while flying.
Sure.
It doesn't say that.
Mm-hmm. And so medium armor as well, right?
Well, no. No medium or heavy.
Okay.
But you could do a high dex melee, mm-hmm. not a strength-based.
Right.
But you could do like a you know, a rapier or,
sure, sure,
or
sure.
a short sword with mm-hmm. a shield and supplement your AC that way. I mean, you could do that.
You could do that.
You take the mobile feat. Here's what I'm saying with that, is you take the mobile feat, and that gives you flyby attack.
If you don't want to have to wait until fourth level for that, Ranger has Zephyr Strike. I guess the only other option is finding some way to get Shock and Grasp. you know, and now you're talking about playing a caster who's in melee, and maybe that's a very sort of like niche, a melee-based bird person caster that you're going for. But I don't know. If that floats your boat, then that's an option.
That's one way of flying.
I know. I think if I was going to play a melee Aarakocra, it would be Ranger. And I choose Ranger over Fighter or Barbarian because I think the spells of Ranger help make up for some of the lack that Aarakocra has, right?
Yeah.
You can pick up Dark Vision through Ranger. You can pick up a little bit of healing, which is going to help because you're probably going to be a little fragile.
Yeah.
There, like I said, Zephyr Strike is a good one for this particular type of concept.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting, right? Like, I'm genuinely curious, how would this play out as a
well,
character?
I mean, you know, even in the fluff text of Aarakocra, you know, they're like Wardens of the Sky.
Right.
I mean, what
right,
does
right.
that sound like? Sounds like a Ranger to me.
Absolutely.
You're a warden of an area. Imagine an Aarakocra just flying over this forest, protecting this one particular area.
Oh, yeah.
You know, whether it's on the prime material or in the plane of air.
These wardens of the air, they're native to the plane of air in baseline sort of D&D lore. And I kind of like that about mm-hmm. about his characters, because that means when they do show up, they have a connection to this otherworldly realm that opens it up as a possibility for play. And the plane of air is a friendlier extraplanar realm to visit, if you're going to visit one, right?
Like yeah.
A flying carpet or a caster willing to do a group fly spell, you know, is all you really need, as opposed to, say, water or earth or fire.
The
a little bit more difficult.
with the access and the length of the water spells, though, like water breathing. I don't know.
That could worry, yeah, if you knew you were going.
It's more about mobility, but anyway, that's a whole other conversation.
Yeah, but it opens up that as a possibility, and you were talking about planar wardens. My Aarakocra archer was a member of a lodge of planar hunters, and he was a hunter ranger. For me, I just, because we were playing a 20th level one shot, I was like, well, his initiation was just getting to level 20. like that's the level you need to be, a level 20 to be to hunt like astral dreadnoughts and Tarrasques and so
it's a very exclusive club.
It's a very exclusive club, but you know, I figure an Aarakocra archer is the kind of character concept that would fit with that. If you are playing high level Dungeons and Dragons, having those sorts of organizations that are like, yeah, this is a planar guardian type organization. They're there to kind of keep the riffraff out or to hunt down the big threats. is something you might do. And a race like Aarakocra fits because they have that planar connection.
Yeah. Right, right. So you go from the very uplifted to the downtrodden.
Oh my God!
It's like night and day. The Kenku, the Edgelord,
servants of the Wind Dukes of Aqua, these noble guardians and champions of the war against Mishka, the Chaos Spider. Yeah, to Kenku, sure.
And then cut them down.
Yeah, cut them down. First off, Kenku are part of a long tradition of Dungeons & Dragons races that have been done wrong by a powerful god, demon, whatever asshole.
And orcs
orcs, drown, gnolls, Dwergar, Darrow. To the point where I find it a difficult trope to accept in my character concepts. Yeah. And I enjoy using baseline D&D's lore and making it my own. I enjoy taking a little bit of what they have and going, what happens if I mix it up with my stuff? And so when I see like yet another, a powerful being cursed this group of people or these creatures to misery and poverty and mistrust, and they took away their creativity. When I look at that, I really have as presented, I'm having trouble seeing how Kenku, first off, are survive as a people, and second off, how they would adventure as an individual. And so that leads me to believe, like, all right, let's find the corner cases, let's find the edges. Where can we start molding things and shaping things so that we can keep this great concept of a corvid trickster, of someone sneaky and deceptive and able to mimic sounds and trick people.
Mimic sounds and words. Yeah. I mean, this is the guy you want to go see. When I think of like the true Kenku, he is the mastermind that sits behind the curtain that is actually being run by the actual mastermind.
Right.
But he can mimic anything.
Right.
And he can forge. You never see his face.
So that's a good point. Like, Kenku makes sort of like a good lieutenant for a big bad. If you're thinking of like concepts in terms of like, how can I fit them in as a DM? Or maybe it's like, you're a Kenku who was that intermediary, and either you lost the master, or in a moment of like, oh my God, what's happening? Like, you just bolt. And you know, you're dealing with this curse. And I think the way I would present the curse, at least the ones where it's like no creativity and no speech, is that it's still there, but something's suppressing it externally. And so I would certainly allow for a Kenku player, like any one of these components of the curse, to incorporate into whatever they want to do and whatever we're planning for the game, to remove it or alter it or bypass it some way.
Like when I played mine, I just assigned his former party. And there were five members of the party, and one was, how I did the whole like different voices, different attitudes thing.
Yeah,
is like
yeah.
for these situations, he would emulate the fighter. For these, the cleric. For these, the druid. For these, the monk.
Yeah,
and that's how I kind of changed it up. And then I started repeating things that the other players would say a little bit. But that mimicry, I mean, if you play a very narrow band of type of character, it works well. Right?
If you're looking to stretch your role playing muscle, certainly. And
yeah.
I think it's a challenge for the Kenku player, and I think a challenge for the group, because when you look in Volos, there's that little sidebar that says like, hey, if you like do a different voice and mannerism and speech that tick and noise for like everything, you might get on people's nerves. And I've played with players who thought that they were like really getting into role playing by acting out and incorporating speech impediments and sort of like stutters and things into their character. Mm-hmm. First off, if you're trying to take something that exists in the real world and you didn't do your homework, then it can just kind of come across as, well, you seem like you don't really know what you're doing. If it's slowing down play, if it's making it difficult to just understand what you want to have happen as a player, the sidebar recommends you just saying, like, my Kenku responds with a series of hammer noises to indicate boredom, or, a whistle to indicate they're ready to move, or, the captain of the guard's voice, you know, to shout out danger or something. And you don't always have to do it, but thinking up what sorts of places have my Kenku been around, what's their background like, what's their past like, what noises and things from that environment can I mimic to give your character some color and bring out the fact that they are creatures that have to mimic things and use what they've found to communicate.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah. And here's the thing. You can always just ignore that. Yeah. Yes, they're really good at mimicry because these birds can do that.
Yeah.
And they're still kind of sneaky, but who cares? You're not, like we've always said, you're not beholden to any of this.
And you're not like forced to have to play a character a certain way just because the baseline lore is like that. If you like the idea of a raven folk, like trickster type, first off, there's raven folk in Kobold Press's Midgard setting, right? Like we always like use their take on it as an alternative to the Kenku. But for the baseline Kenku, you could just say, hey, listen, there's very little magic in Dungeons & Dragons that's absolute. Didn't my guy get a save against this curse? Can I not roll some dice and just like do a thing? And maybe you roll a random, and which one of these do you keep? Mm-hmm. You know, are you a Kenku with flight and you still have a limited capacity for flight? And maybe it's more like a 30-foot flight speed or something like that to reflect the fact that Aarakocra are like fast birds of prey. They're like raptors and hawks and things like that. And Kenku are less so. But man, the no creativity thing is like a killer for me. Like, how do you get past that when you're thinking of character concepts? Because they're pretty clear in Volos that like, yeah, they don't have any creativity. And in my mind, I go like, how do they adapt and survive at all?
Well, I mean, I think it's more just like they have long memories. So once they see someone do something, they know how to do it. Mm. So they may not think of how to solve a problem the first time, but then they see someone solve this problem and now they can do that.
Sure. Okay.
It's just like a base programming thing.
So then I'm thinking that like the feat that I want for my Kenku is Keen Mind.
Yeah.
You know, and do they not already have a version of that just in the necessity of...
Well, they can mimic anything.
The more I take the baseline Kenku and sort of like talk it out, the more I'm like, I'd change some part of this. And I think for me, either going the criminal route of like, these are people, these are not like, they don't constitute a distinct people. They constitute a class of people, certainly a type of criminal, but they're not like a culture or race of people. Or they're like, lean it the other way and go, okay, they're not cursed. They still have that connection to whatever mystical entity it was. Like, maybe it's a trickster god or the Raven Queen or something else. And the reputation they have is sort of standoffish, not because they're seen as vagabonds and thieves and gutter folk, but they're seen as like, wow, they have a strong connection to some kind of thing that lets them tap into this ability to mimic anything. Maybe it's like a god of knowledge, you know, and the fact that they can recall anything that they read or see reflects their connection to that deity, that, okay, the eyes of my people have seen it, therefore we have all seen it, kind of thing. I find the tragic, these people were cursed and their lives really suck now, to just be one that works in small doses, but and there's just too much of it, in my opinion. So I that's how I would tweak Kenku.
I just thought of a trickster cleric Kenku that is prophesizing that the Raven Queen is going to bring back our wings.
Ooh, yeah, right.
That'd be a way to play a Kenku.
Uh-huh, sure.
Getting wings.
Getting wings. Let's talk about
wings.
This is the problem with a lot of
these. This is the winged elephant in the room.
Yeah.
The big problem DMs have, some DMs have.
Yeah.
PC, first level, flight. Would you allow it?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So for DMs out there, who might have a problem with this, oh, this just breaks the game, I can't, no, not at my table. Yeah. Like, what would be your advice to them? Would you try to convince them?
I think I would say this, and this is why, let me back up. Let me make sure I have my thoughts in order first. I don't know that I'm gonna try to convince you that you should have flying PCs in your game at first level. I think what I am gonna do is I'm gonna explain why I will. For several reasons. I think that the number of obstacles in which having a flying PC renders that obstacle and the challenge that should come with that obstacle uninteresting and lower the stakes of it such that why are we even playing this out is low. I think that the amount of times that I run games where a flying PC would so significantly change whatever I was trying to do to challenge the party in that moment. And when I think about it, I just am like, well, number one, the kinds of challenges, and I'm thinking more like environmental challenges, traps, things in which, say, the low-level party might have to climb or scale something, or they can't gain access to it because of a vertical distance that that they can't surpass at this point. And I just go, well, number one, there's a low instance of that. So the instances where a flying PC would just completely obliterate that are going to be low. Second off, it opens up so many options. Think of all the places that low-level parties can't get to because they don't have someone who can fly to say, like, fly up and attach a rope, or just enough flight to be able to, say, carry someone up or something. This is a good place for me to mention that I would allow a race like Aarakocra, or even, say, the Avian from Planeshift that we didn't really talk about, but they're very Aarakocra-like, mm-hmm. To carry heavier loads. It's just that you can't end your turn flying. You have to go from point A to point B with your flight speed. It's flying castles. Vertical distances that they can get to, a hole in the ceiling of a natural cavern that leads to some secret part of a you know, the cave network mm-hmm. that they're exploring that otherwise they wouldn't be able to get to without a lot of time and rope. And so all of those things open up because I have a PC who is flying at first level. So not only do I think that the instances where it's going to be a problem and negate some sort of challenge in the game are low, but it opens up way too much for me not to want to say yes to that. Mm-hmm. And then there are practical concerns, though, right? Like having a flying archer will render many combat challenges trivial. I changed that by varying my tactics, by not always having conditions be favorable to that particular character. If it's a race like Aarakocra, then I will probably really enforce the fact that, yeah, they've got like a claustrophobia level aversion to enclosed spaces, right? Like their home is a realm of pure air and nothing, like mm-hmm. they're earth motes, but why are you gonna think you can just walk underground without any problems? You know, I'm gonna need to start like making charisma saves to keep your shit together.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of thing.
Gotta get out, man. We gotta get out.
That's how I would enforce it, right? Yeah. A short-term madness. Wisdom or charisma. I like charisma because I sort of see charisma as that ability to keep your cool. And I'm fine changing what a save does or what it uses. That's where I start with it. And, you know, it is a ranged or is a flying caster or archer getting the better of my encounters, then I expect to see more flyers in the encounters I prepare. Expect to see more ground-based anti-aircraft, basically anti-flyer measures.
Yeah, I mean, why don't you have archers shooting at them? Specifically, yeah. They are by themselves up in the air.
In many ways, being by yourself, a lone target in the great blue sky, is not that great. And then it's like, okay, well, are you going to then use, say, the tops of trees or tall buildings as cover? And you might have the mobility to do that. You might have the freedom of movement to do that. Another great reason to be a ranger in Aarakocra. I don't see that as a problem. Mm-hmm. I'm now, that first off, that's a dynamism to the fight. If the archer's sort of like moving in between cover and out of cover, well, I have readied actions to help take care of that, vice versa for the players. If I send other flyers after them, are they fast, speedy flyers that are just going to have to, I'm going to have to send in mass because some of them are going to die? Or is it like a big bruiser that maybe can't catch up with them, but might be able to get the drop on them if they're in tight spaces or something like that?
Yeah.
Those are all things that I will consider. I've got the entire monster manual in my imagination at my disposal to deal with a flying character. And I think I'm always going to be able to come up with something. And sometimes it's okay if they render the challenge trivial. You know, that's fine too. Mm-hmm. So that's where I feel about it. And I think that, you know, if you're going for a certain type of game in terms of tone, in terms of a feel for it, you like that low-level sword and sorcery, like my wizards have to sweat blood and tears to get their spells, and my warriors are mighty thewed and have, you know, understand the riddle of steel, then maybe Aarakocra aren't a fit for you. But if you're playing Forgotten Realms, then I think that they're fine. And try it out if you're worried about it. What's the worst that could happen? Talk to your players, et cetera, et cetera.
Also, I like to think about the forecast for the day.
Oh, yes, right. Weather, yeah.
I mean, are there high winds? Because on the ground, that may not matter, but I mean, if there are high winds, that should be affecting your ranged attacks anyway. Mm-hmm. And if you have an Aarakocra that's flying around, it might be difficult terrain. You want to move anywhere, it's going to cost that double movement because
there's a 20 mile an hour crosswind.
Yeah, that's a very good point.
Don't overuse that, obviously. Unless that's just a feature of the plane. Yeah,
that's why you use tools to see whether how windy is it today, or what's it like, or the fact that you know the enemies who've been observing you have brought someone who's skilled in air magic. You know, there are spells, nets, grappling hooks, lassos. Web them next to a surface. I have a ready to action for a web. As soon as they fly by that building, I'm going to splatter them to it. I stretched it between the branches of two trees, and that's how they're going to get it. Or there's a lot of different ways to take them down. And more than likely, and DMs, you might not enjoy hearing this. If you find that flying PCs are getting the better of you, it is time to up your game. It is time to find ways to improve your encounters and find ways to vary the environmental counters that you're, environmental challenges rather that you want to throw at them. And I think that, as you're playing the game, everything's evolving, everything's changing. The types of enemies you face, the types of threats that you have to deal with, no different than this. Mm-hmm. You have to adapt and change, and that's all right. That's many times a great way to improve your DMing skills. So, yeah.
Head on over to Patreon for our weekly podcast and so much more. WebDM is also on Twitch with 3 weekly games, which we upload to WebDM Plays, our second YouTube channel. All right, well, there you go. Damn.
Not bad. That was way more than I thought we'd talk about.
I know. I totally forgot to talk about the Kenku monk.
Oh, yeah.
But my mind was like, to a badass Kenku monk. He's all like dubbed badly.
He
makes all the yes. Actually lean into the Bruce Lee thing.
Kenku monk. We forgot to talk about the Avian and the others. Like to me, I was reading through that plane shift article.
Oh yeah, and the Avira. Yeah, mm-hmm.
From Dark Matter. To me, the Avian were like, I felt like I read the fluff for them, and I was like, okay, there's hawk headed ones. First off, I like that they're like human bodies. Bird head, wings.
Yeah,
I like that imagery, right? Like, it says like hawk people have short wings for faster flight, and it's like, but you guys both have 30-foot fly speed, like.
Yeah, but we get there faster.
Yeah, and then it's like, and they dive attack, which sometimes does more damage to them than the others. Like, look for no dive attack. Like, minotaurs get charge, centaurs get trample, and so I just was like, I like the concept of these, but I feel like they could have used a different. Yeah.